I begin.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So I mainly started with fuzzy set theory because my research work is going in, you know, in the direction of uncertain database systems, where you, you know, come up with methods where you deal with data that's either incomplete or imprecise. And there are many ways to represent data which is incomplete and imprecise. I think most of you probably know probabilistic graphical models and what are there? I don't know. Yeah, probably those. And another way to actually represent them are using is using fuzzy set theory, basically. So while relational algebra for non-incomplete or non-uncertain data is built on set theory, the same operators for uncertain data is usually built on, uncertain data represented using fuzzy sets is built on fuzzy set theory. So this was actually my motivation to start reading fuzzy set theory. And basically fuzzy set theory came around the 1960s. That was actually when people started realizing that, you know, there were problems that we can't solve using point, I think it's called point logic or point arithmetic, where you try to, you know, assign variables for everything and have definite values for everything. I think most of those problems that you can't solve like this appear mostly in, what is it called, quantum chemistry. And I think the method that they use to solve some problems are, is it quantum mechanics? I'm not sure. I just skimmed through it. And you have statistical models to represent these. So basically problems have been split up for years before the 1960s into problems which are very simple and problems which are considered to be organized and complex. So organized complex problems are what you can solve using statistical theory. But they realized around the 1960s that there's a spectrum between what you consider simple problems that you can solve with point value arithmetic and you know, what you can solve with statistics. There's a spectrum of problems which can't be solved by just either one or the other way. And they need a method of representation and arithmetic in between to be able to solve these problems. So that's how fuzzy set theory was born. And they also had to, around that time, they had to start accepting that uncertainty was a given and that you can't accurately represent a system without including uncertainty. I was actually going to do a normal set review, but I don't know if there's anybody in the anybody listening that doesn't know normal set theory. Is there anybody who wants to revise like normal set theory? Okay, nobody's saying anything, so I'm not sure if there's anybody who wants to do normal set theory. But anyway, I just skimmed through all of this. So the sets that we classically use are called crisp sets, and that's actually an accepted term. So what are crisp sets? Basically, they're sets with whose members are either included in the set or not included in the set. So you can actually write a function for each crisp set that gives one for every single element in the set that belongs to the set and zero if it doesn't belong to the set. So throughout this whole talk, the capital set X will denote the universe set or the set of discourse. Basically, it has all the elements that could possibly be anywhere. So in all your Venn diagrams, it's that nice big box. So for crisp sets, you have a function called the characteristic function, which for every element in the universal set, it gives the value one if that element belongs to set A, and it gives the value zero if it doesn't. So that's basically the characteristic function for a crisp set. And why I'm explaining this is because this crisp set represents the typical two-valued logic that we've been using in sets so far, where, you know, an element either belongs to the set or does not belong to the set, and there are no in-betweens. So that's what a crisp set represents. And you have some fundamental properties of crisp set operations. So you have involution, where I think all of you know what a complement is. So the complement of a complement is the same thing. You have commutativity, associativity. do I need to do this? Like, I think everybody knows. I can't tell if anybody's saying anything. Okay. Anyway, you have associativity, distributivity, idempotence. I'm just going to skip through these. Absorption, identity is fine. So the two I'm going to focus on because they're going to change is the law of contradiction. The law of contradiction just says that if you have a set and its complement, they have no common elements in between. So that they're disjoint sets and they're exhaustive. So this is where the exhaustivity comes, the law of excluded middle. So these two are important properties. And last but not least, you have De Morgan's laws where you can distribute, we can't distribute, where, you know, the laws which involve the negation and the union and intersection operators. So and another important point I'll stress is about this concept of a Boolean lattice. In normal set theory, you have such a lattice where you have these points which are called joins and meets. So when you have two sets and you take the union of those sets, it's a join. And when you have two sets and you take the intersection of the set, it's a meet. So basically, you'll be able to make a lattice using the set inclusion operator. And the set inclusion operator, you can also define the same lattice using the intersection and union operators. So partitions, basically, if you can take a set, let's say set A, and make multiple subsets out of set A such that the union of all these sets is set A, and the pairwise intersection is null, then it's called a partition. So basically, you're able to you make sure that for every element in A, it falls only to one of the partition blocks, and that every element of A is in exactly one partition block. So, so I think all of you know what a partition is. So I'm going to skip through this also. Yeah, so all, in partition, you divide it into blocks. So all A's are called blocks. And okay, refinement is not important, so. Next concept I'll revise is the concept of a nested family. If you have a family of sets A, the family index by A1, so on till AN, such that you'll be able to write a sequence AI is a subset of AJ, then it just means that the family of sets A is a nested family. So that's about it. Okay, cool. I don't want to revise this. Okay, so now coming to the main part of this talk, fuzzy sets, the basic theory of fuzzy sets. So before I explain what a crisp set was, and that every element in the universe of discourse or the universal set X can either belong to a given set A or cannot belong to a given set A. So that's two-valued logic. But in fuzzy sets, you can actually, instead of stating that something belongs to a set or does not belong to a set, you can give each element a membership grade in the set. So that basically says that if, for example, what's the best example? Wait, I think I have a. Okay, yeah. So for example, I want to define a fuzzy set A, with where I want the fuzzy set A to denote numbers that are close to two. So this definition, these concepts like close or hot or far or near or high, all these concepts are linguistic concepts that don't have a definite boundary or definition that you can give to something. So when you have concepts like these, the boundaries around these concepts are very, very fuzzy, and you use fuzzy sets to represent these kinds of concepts. So for instance, if I want to represent the set of all real numbers close to two, for every single number in the set of real numbers, I'm going to give it a grade. And the grade can range between, let's say, 0 and 1. Then this set is a possible representation of what a fuzzy set looks like. So for every single element X in the set of all real numbers, I give it a grade anywhere between 0 to 1, indicating that this number, the number on X, is close to 2. So, So fuzzy sets allow us to express vague logic, like, a number is really close to 2. Another thing that's important about fuzzy sets is fuzzy sets, the definition of a fuzzy set is very dependent on the context of when you're using the fuzzy set. For instance, if you tell me that this temperature is hot, maybe in Chennai, or you tell me that this temperature is hot somewhere in an iron furnace, then what is considered hot in Chennai is very different from what is considered hot in a furnace. So fuzzy set definitions are dependent on the linguistic concept itself, and also dependent on the context in which this definition is being used. So those are two important things to remember about fuzzy sets. And there are multiple membership functions that you can have for a fuzzy set, even for the same concept. For instance, this exact example where we're stating that X is a real number close to 2, then this first graph obviously represents a fuzzy set, because for all numbers until 1, the membership grade is 0. It means they're not at all close to 2. For all numbers greater than 3, the membership grade is again 0, because they're not at all close to 2. And somewhere in between, they have this nice triangular function where it peaks at 2. It's 1. That means it's in complete membership of this set. And everywhere else, it degrades linearly. But there are multiple functions that can represent this exact concept. So you have this function, you have this function, and you have these two functions as well. So even though they represent the same concept, they look different. But if you notice, they have similarities because they represent the same concept. They all peak at 1. And after 3, they all kind of, after 3 and before 1, they all kind of fizzle up. So yeah, that's basically an example of a fuzzy set. Another example that, if somebody asks me questions, I think they'll post on the chat or they'll ask, never mind.
Can I ask one right now?
What? Yeah.
Can I ask a question right now? Yeah, sorry. So you showed us 4 membership functions, A1, A2, A3, A4, describing the same concept, right?
Yeah.
So even though the concept is the same, do the different membership functions make the set different? So for example, is the fuzzy set described by A1 different from the fuzzy set described by A2? Because the concept is the same, but you just have a different membership function for the grade. So does that make the set different, or
yeah,
how does that work?
Set different in a crisp set, you completely define your crisp set based on your characteristic function, right? So that's what makes a set. The A is just the name, right? It doesn't matter. The characteristic function is what matters. That's what defines the set.
Okay, right. So yeah, so I just wanted to be clear on that. Function is like the definition of the set. The function, not the description.
Exactly.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. But one nice thing they found is, at least in applications, it hasn't mattered that much which functions you use. Not much anyway. So I don't have to worry that much about picking a membership function, but I'll come to that picking a membership function later. This is another example of a fuzzy set. So basically you have 5 fuzzy sets here. You have very low, low, medium, high, and very high, which they're trying to put temperatures from T1 to T2 into these sets. So if you look at the crisp set, which is B, it's at the bottom, you notice that the boundaries are not fuzzy at all. They're incredibly tight, but this doesn't make a lot of sense, because if suppose you are at the boundary of this medium set, if you add just 1 to the temperature, then you're going to go to high, and that makes no sense, because the you can't have the distinction between two concepts like medium and high with one value. It's similar to that how many grains of sand problem or an inductive proof to show that if you even try to adjust these boundaries by saying, you know, if it's just +1, then I don't care, as we consider it as medium, then eventually what happens is you consider almost all of it to be medium. So crisp boundaries for concepts like these, for applications like these, don't make sense. So we actually define fuzzy boundaries for these. I'll explain more about this also later. I just want to show you what fuzzy sets look like. So they basically look like this. They're not exclusive. They just tell you for each temperature, they just tell you how likely is it to be in the set. And you might, at this point, you probably are wondering, you know, that sounds exactly like probability theory. And it does sound exactly like probability theory. Fuzzy sets is actually fuzzy set theory is actually a generalization of what probability theory can do. So I'll come to that also later. So there can be many fuzzy sets. The fuzzy set I've been using so far, where I say, you know, the membership grade we give to any element in the universe, in the universal set, is between 0 and 1. They're actually called ordinary fuzzy sets. But fuzzy sets need not be this way. You need not give them a grade just between 0 and 1. There can be multiple types of fuzzy sets. So one type is ordinary fuzzy sets, which actually we'll continue to use throughout this talk. I won't really, you know, differ from this concept much. I'll just tell you what other fuzzy sets are there. Now, we're always trying to accept the amount of uncertainty and fuzziness that's there in the system. So based on the grade, so based on how much uncertainty you're willing to accept into your system, you can level up your fuzzy sets as you go. So one type of fuzzy set is this interval valued fuzzy set, where I'll show you directly with the figure. Yeah. So where instead of you, let me show it you this way. Okay. Yeah. So where instead of you giving me a value between 0 and 1, one value to represent the membership grade, you instead represent a closed interval between 0 and 1 to represent the grade. So that means you're telling me that, for instance, this point A, the membership grade is not a single, it's not a single value between 0 and 1, but I'm telling you that the membership grade can be anywhere between alpha 1 and alpha 2. So that's basically what an interval valued fuzzy set is. So it accepts the uncertainty and it includes it in the definition of the membership function. So that's how interval valued fuzzy sets work. Why are they not used? Because as you increase the fuzziness, it also becomes computationally more demanding. So as you increase the amount of uncertainty your representation or your set type takes, it will take longer for you, or it becomes harder for you to process it takes longer to process. So then we also have fuzzy sets of type 2, where instead of, I think this is where like it starts derailing a little bit, but instead of providing a single number between 0 and 1, or even an interval between 0 and 1, for each element X in the universe, you provide a fuzzy set, which becomes the membership grade. So your membership grade itself is a fuzzy set. I think it's better that I show you with a graph. Yeah. Okay. So now if you look at point A, instead of me giving someone an interval or even a single point, I'm actually going to define this fuzzy set. So this fuzzy set is actually the membership grade of the function, of A for the set A, of small a for the set big A. So is this confusing? Is anybody confused at this point? Like, or do you want some time to accept this? We're not really going to use
I didn't really get this, but if it's not useful for the rest.
Yeah, it's not useful. Oh, you think nobody got this? Okay.
Cool. I mean, I get it, but like...
Yeah. This is not useful. So you can always escalate it and you get it, you get the point, no? So you can constantly making it more and more complex by... making each of these fuzzy grades also fuzzy and so on. So
anybody
would want to do that, but you can do it.
My question here is this. So ordinary fuzzy sets, right? The membership function can sort of map to something meaningful. Okay, forget meaningful concepts. Just that the membership function can, the range of the membership function can be ordered. So zero elements from 0 to 1, you can order them. So if I tell you the membership of this is 0.3 and the membership of something else is 0.5, irrespective of whatever those numbers mean, you can order them, right? Whereas you cannot compare fuzzy sets. So I don't understand what it fundamentally means to map each element to another fuzzy set. That is one. And secondly, based on this presentation, it looks like ordinary fuzzy sets are something sort of fundamentally different from higher order fuzzy sets.
I mean,
it seems to be a different description itself, you know?
Yeah, I understand. But this, what we call ordinary fuzzy sets, are this subset that you have 0 and 1. It's 0 to 1. This is a subset of what this could represent, what any of this could represent, what this could represent. It's a subset. So even crisp sets are subsets of fuzzy sets. So they're not subsets, sorry, a type of fuzzy sets. So crisp okay. sets can be encapsulated in fuzzy sets. So you'll see all properties that are generalized for fuzzy sets. They apply to crisp sets also. So they apply the same way that crisp set operations would have applied. Like, did that answer your question?
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I mean, okay. I mean, okay, fine. I think you can take some time to internalize that. And maybe you can get back to me or something. Okay. Okay, I'm skipping through this then if it doesn't matter. This is the last thing I'll cover. So based on types at least. So basically, instead of mapping, you know, X to numbers or to any intervals, you could even map all elements of X to any set L which is at least partially ordered. So you can basically say, you know, the membership grade of 2.5 being the set that is close to 2 is apples or oranges or whatever, as long as it's at least partially ordered. So those are called L fuzzy sets. Yeah, I'm not going to go to level 2. Level 2 is basically where you make the left-hand side fuzzy, as in when you can't even define the universe properly, you start making the universe itself fuzzy. So, and then you have a combination where you can make the universe and the membership grades fuzzy. So that's where I'll stop with that. Okay, so usually when you know, new definitions are made, you try to put like operators on top of it, and you need a basis for those operators to work, right? So the basis in fuzzy sets is to try to define a set of crisp sets that can represent these fuzzy sets. So therein we start this concept of something called an alpha cut. Before I move on, I just want to make sure everybody understood what an ordinary fuzzy set is. I think the concept is simple, but you need to understand for the rest of the talk. I think you do. I'm just going to move on. And if you don't, like, I don't know what Anirudh's rules are, but you can just either start talking or put it on the chat. I don't care. So the concept that we define next is the concept of an alpha cut, and the concept is very simple. So an alpha cut of A is basically all elements X that belong to the universal set, such that the membership grade of X is greater than alpha. So that's an alpha cut. And a strong alpha cut is basically all the elements of X from the universe whose membership grade is greater than alpha and not greater than equal to, like for an alpha cut. So that's basically what an alpha cut and a strong alpha cut are. So now you probably are wondering, okay, how do other normal set operations scale or change? So I'll give you, I'll give you one example of how alpha cuts help. So basically how do you define convexity for a fuzzy set is, you state that a fuzzy set is convex if all alpha cuts are also convex. That's basically the definition of convexity for a fuzzy set. Coming back. The level set of A, that's a very simple concept. So basically, if I told you I need, like, instead of representing alpha A's for every single alpha in 0 to 1, you just pick all the alpha such that you get a unique alpha cut for every single alpha. So that's basically the definition. So the level set of A basically contains all alpha such that there exists an X such that the membership grade is alpha. So that would mean that every time you take alpha within the level set of A, you're going to get different alpha cuts. I think that's also intuitively fine, or should be fine. So a natural property, an obvious property related to alpha cuts would be if you have two alphas, alpha 1 and alpha 2, such that alpha 2 is smaller than alpha 1, then naturally the set of elements whose membership grade is greater than alpha 1 will be less than the set of elements whose membership grade or the size, the membership grade whose of elements is greater than alpha 2. Sorry, I'm struggling with this. So obviously if the membership grade is greater than alpha 1, then it's obviously going to be greater than alpha 2. So that's why if your alphas are increasing, then your set inclusion order is decreasing. That's how it goes. So yeah. And if you have a family of all cuts, they form, if you have a family of all the cuts, they form families of nested crisp sets. Does everybody at least understand this, you know, what alpha sets are, and have intuition for what alpha sets represent and all that? Like if you've taken data analytics, or you've done, if you've done, what's it called? Frequent pattern mining, then you'll probably know what this concept represents when I say is greater than alpha or something. So I'm moving on, assuming that everybody understands.
Describe level set again. I understood the subset relations and all that. Yeah, I understood alpha cuts and the subset relations at the last slide. But yeah, I didn't quite understand level set.
I can explain what an alpha cut is. One second.
Okay. No, not alpha cut, the level set. I understood what alpha cut is.
Yeah, actually. Sorry. Yeah, I'll explain what a level set is. So, is this the right example to take? Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think this is the right example to take. It's fine. So, okay, this is not the right example. I need a discrete. I don't have a discrete. Okay, fine. I'll explain it in words again. Okay, so suppose I have just two elements in my universe set. So you have just two elements, x1 and x2. Okay. And the membership grade of x1 in set A is 1. And not one, okay. The membership grade of set of element x1 in set A is, let's say, 0.2, and the membership grade of element x2 in set A is 0.5, right? So okay. Now imagine if I ask you to find the alpha cut when alpha is equal to 0.25, that will be x2, right?
Yeah.
And now if I ask you to find the alpha cut of 0.3, that will still be x2, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So basically the level set basically defines all alphas, or is a set of all alphas such that you have, for every single alpha in this level set, the alpha set you generate will be different. So you get unique alpha sets for each single element in alpha. So if I gave you that same set where the membership grade of X1 is 0.2 and the membership grade of X2 is 0.5, then your alphas will be 0.2 and 0.5, right? Because at alpha equal to 0.2, your alpha cut will contain both x1 and x2. And at alpha equal to 0.5, your alpha cut will contain only x2. So that makes sense.
So is it sort of like transition points, or transition alphas or something?
Yeah, they're transition alphas, yeah. Exactly. They're transition alphas.
Okay, fine. I mean, So your definition based on alpha cuts is fine, but is there a reason you're not defining it as the possible values of the membership function?
Possible values of the membership function? Oh, because, see, the membership function is, okay, so you can define the membership function for each value in, okay, how do I?
So, okay, so for example, hello, can you hear me? Yeah, so for example, instead of talking about alpha cuts, I say that I literally use your definition on the slide. Like the level set of A is the set of all alpha such that there exists an element whose membership grade is alpha. That's it. So is this definition not equivalent to your level set definition?
This definition is equivalent to my level set definition.
Okay, all right. Yeah, that's all I wanted to ask, because I thought since you're talking about level sets for this, is not talking about alpha cuts for this slide. I thought it was something different.
No, that's it. It's the same thing. They just mean the same thing. That's it.
Okay. Cool. Okay.
I think I did this slide. Okay. Okay. Then some more terminology is basically all elements from the universe set which have a positive membership grade are called the support of A. So basically every element which has a grade of 0 is definitely not going to be in A. So everything else is in the support of A. The core of A is everything, every single element which completely belongs to A. So its membership grade is 1. The height of fuzzy set A is the maximum membership grade it's given to any element on the set. So yeah, so that's the height. A fuzzy set is called normal if the maximum membership grade it gives out is 1. And it's called subnormal if the membership grade is maximum membership grade is less than 1. So that's something simple. I did this. This is unnecessary. Should I show you examples of? I'm not going to use convexity, so it's fine. Okay. So any property that you generalize from crisp set theory or classical set theory into fuzzy set theory, such that it is preserved in all the alpha cuts. And you know all the alpha cuts are normal sets, as in crisp sets. Those properties are called Kattuvatti properties. And if the same property is preserved in all alpha cuts, then it is called a strong Kattuvatti property. So there can be properties which are strong Kattuvatti and not Kattuvatti, or you know Kattuvatti and not strong Kattuvatti. But an example is convexity. Convexity has been shown to be both Kattuvatti and strong Kattuvatti. So I think this definition is fine. Basically, it's just saying that if you want to call if a property has been, or if a property is Kattuvatti, then if you want to define a fuzzy set to be, you know, to be true for some proposition. Okay, so let me go back to convexity itself. So if you want to tell me that a fuzzy set is convex, then you have to take every single alpha cut from that fuzzy set, and you have to show me that every single alpha cut set is convex in the classical sense. Then and only then will the fuzzy set itself be convex. So that's what Kattuvatti and strong Kattuvatti properties are. And to me, the main part is basically how these operators work, and how is it that I can perform arithmetic on fuzzy sets. So the nice thing about fuzzy sets is that unlike normal sets, there's no actual exact definition, mathematical definition for what, I mean, it kind of is, but there's no strict function that you have to use. For set operations like intersection, union, and complement, like you did for normal set theory. But they do define some operators called the standard set of operations, where you define the standard complement of a fuzzy set, denoted by the normal set set denotion that you know for complement, which is just so even the complement is a fuzzy set. So the membership function of the complement of A is nothing else but 1 minus the membership of A, membership function of A. So that means any element in X, if its membership in the set A was A of X, then its membership in the complement of A is 1 minus A of X. So I think that's okay. And we define some points called equilibrium points, where the membership grade in a set and in the set's complement is the same, then they're called equilibrium points. I'm sorry, the notes, the slides are so extensive because these are actually my notes for the textbook. So I don't want to make new ones. And you also define a standard intersection and union operations. So the intersection of two fuzzy sets is also a fuzzy set, and the membership grade of any element in the intersection of two fuzzy sets is nothing else but the minimum of the two membership grades. Similarly, you can also define the union of two fuzzy sets, and the grade of an element X in the union of the two fuzzy sets is nothing else but the maximum of the two grades. So I think this is incredibly clear, right? It's intuitive also for you to understand it this way, that you'd expect that the membership of an element such that the membership of an element that you want to check if an element belongs to both set A and B, then you look at the minimum membership grade, and if it belongs to either, then you look at the maximum. So for me, it's intuitive. I don't know if it's intuitive for you, but yeah. Now we define the subset operation. So basically you say a fuzzy set A is a subset of fuzzy set B if and only if for every single element X in the universe, the membership grade of X and A is less than or equal to the membership grade of X and B. So that's how you define set inclusion in fuzzy sets. So yeah, oh, I'll pause for questions. I'll pause for questions in a few slides. similar to the Boolean lattice that you have for crisp sets, you also have a similar lattice for De Morgan. So you have a similar lattice for fuzzy sets. It's called the De Morgan lattice, and you can make this lattice is defined on the operations of again the standard intersection and union that we saw in the slide. So standard intersection and union playing the roles of meet and join. So the interesting part now about the standard operations that we defined here is that if you remember the original properties I showed you about normal crisp sets, the last two properties were the law of contradiction and the law of excluded middle. So the law of contradiction was basically if you take a set and intersect it with its complement, then you're going to get an empty set. And if you take a set and union it with its complement, then you're going to get the whole universe set. And it's easy to see why in the case of intersection that, you know, you're not going to get the set phi. Because if A had an element whose membership grade was, element X's membership grade was, I don't know, let's say 0.4 or something. And according to this definition, the membership grade of the same X in the complement of A is going to be 0.6. So if you try to find the intersection grade, then it's not going to be zero, like, you know, you it would be for crisp sets, but it's going to be 0.4. So yeah. And these are not needed. I don't use them anywhere. Okay. So an alternate representation of fuzzy sets, not just based on the membership function alone, or based on the membership function, but when you don't define it as, or when you don't, yeah, when you don't define it as a function that you can write analytically, and you have a finite number of elements in the universe set, then you can define an alternate representation for a fuzzy set A, which is equal to the first element A1 slash. This is not a division operator. This is just a slash, and the membership grade for A1. So I think. Oh wait, sorry, it's the other way around. So the membership grade slash the element, I think. Yeah. So you can just define it as the membership grade slash the element plus the membership grade. So this is again not plus, this is just a included in the set type thing. So that's basically how another alternative representation of a set goes. Okay, if it has finite support, that makes sense. You can't define this if you have infinite support, so that makes sense. Okay, I'll actually stop here for any questions. I can't tell if anybody understands. If not, I'll move on.
I have a question.
Huh?
I have a question.
Okay, cool. So at this point, I also had questions. I was like, but it looks very much like probability theory. I don't know how this is so much more different and all that. So this visualization kind of helped me out, actually. So
wait, does it satisfy the probability axioms?
It doesn't have to satisfy the probability axioms.
Yeah. Okay.
Nice, I'll come to that. I was actually leading up to that. You totally like stole my thunder. Okay.
Sorry. Yeah. No, but you said it's like probability. So I thought I missed something.
No, you didn't miss something. I missed. Okay. Like it's fine, dude. I'm slower than you. Like. I didn't think about all this and all. Okay. Anyway, my problem was that, you know, because of the, like when I was reading this, I did not know that there were going to be other definitions of complements. When I looked at this definition of complement, all I could think of was, how is this different from probability theory? But anyway, let's see. So an interesting visualization for this is, if you have the universe set with n elements in the universe set, and let's say you construct you have three elements in the universe set, okay? Don't look at this 2D one, I like the 3D one better. So you have three elements of the universe set. So 1, 0, 0 just represents a set where the first element is completely in the set and the second two elements are completely not in the set. And 1, 0, 1 represents, you know, the first and third element are completely in the set and the second one is completely not in the set and so on. And within the cube, you have all this fuzziness where an element is partly in the set, an element is partly out of the set and all that. So naturally, all the vertices represent the power set of those three elements. So you have all possible sets, including those three, made out of those three elements. And then this nice triangle that you have here, is actually what probability distributions can represent. Because in probability distributions, all the membership rates have to sum to one, right? So if I take an element and I say, if I take a property like hot and then I equate it to some value, then if you tell me all these values can represent hot, then I'll probably like say, you know, this one represents hot more or so on. So you can actually put it probabilistically and say, you know, that the it's more likely for this member to be hot, I mean, to be considered hot than the other element. And you can normalize them and make them, you know, a probability distribution. But this one plane is what probability distribution can represent. And the whole cube inside it can represent fuzzy sets. So at least to me, this was what kind of like convinced me that, okay, they might be different. But later some other things did convince me that they could be different. So this is one interesting representation for me, at least. I don't know if I have time to go through this? No, right? What is the time? Okay, no, I'm going to do the interesting bits and leave the boring bits. Okay, as I told you before, your fuzzy operations need not be the standard fuzzy operations that were decided upon before. They could be anything, and not just anything, but you get to intuitively define what you would want the complement to be. Not you, but someone did. Now we're going to look at complements. So basically a complement is a function which is going to map the set 0, 1 to 0, 1 naturally, because all your membership grades are from between 0, 1. So if you want to find the complement of A, if you want to find the membership grade of X in the complement of A, you'd basically just perform the C complement function on A of X. I think that's fine, that you probably understand. So the complement function need not like map the value of X itself to some complement of A membership grade, but it only needs to map the grade that A would give to some other grade that the complement of A would give to the same element. I'll keep it very simple and brush through this. Yeah. So basically you have two basic axioms that any function that represents the complement should satisfy. First, if the membership grade originally was 0, the complement should be 1. If the membership grade originally was 1, the complement should be 0. And these are what we call boundary conditions, and these are what enforce the fact that fuzzy complements also work on crisp sets. So this property will make sure it also works on crisp sets. And the second axiom that has to be followed is if a membership grade A is less than a membership grade B, then the complement of that membership grade A should be greater than the complement of membership grade B. That makes sense, because you're saying that if an element X belonging to a set, belonging to set, I don't know, some Y or something, is greater than the membership grade another element has, then let me give it names. If X1 is more likely to be in set A, then X1 should be less likely to be in set B. So that's basically the what this definition means. So it basically represents monotonicity of this function. And you get to add extra axioms if you want to. So you can always like add more properties to your function. So other two properties that can be added is, you make C a continuous function, you make C involutive. So this can be done. I'm going to quickly. So basically one example of a function which can represent the first two axioms, that is boundary conditions and monotonicity, is the thresholding function. One function that can represent the first two axioms and also be continuous is this function. And lastly, one function that takes all four axioms, that is, it also includes strict monotonicity that we saw, is this kind of parameterized function, which you can see is also involutive in nature. So that's nice. The similar process for fuzzy intersection. So even in the intersection, you're going to define, your intersection is going to become a function which takes a membership grade of X in A and membership grade of X in B, and gives you the membership grade of X in A intersection B. So it takes two arguments, two membership grades, 0, 1, 0, 1, and gives you some 0, 1. Yeah, so again, you have an axiomatic skeleton for fuzzy intersection. I don't know if I should go through this. No, I'm actually going to skip it. So because it's, to me, it's fine. You can read this and it doesn't give you any new ideas. So basically what we take away from fuzzy intersections and unions is that you can define a set. So there's a basic skeleton which your intersection or union function should satisfy, but you get to customize the function some more and add more axioms to it, or even take away some axioms from it to suit your context. I mean, you can argue and say that, you know, that's something that people normally already do, but it's not as constrained as your crisp set intersection operators. This is the last thing I'll kind of talk about because it's slightly interesting. So the last thing I'll talk about is something we call the linguistic variable. So probably now you know what a fuzzy set looks like. You know what operators can be performed. So you probably have questions like, okay, now how do I use this? Like how do I use such a fuzzy set, or how can I, you know, what's the point of such a fuzzy set? Then and one question I had when I was looking at fuzzy sets is, if I wanted to take a decision, right, and the boundaries are very fuzzy, how do I take such a decision? Like what is going to be my criteria? Like, aren't I finally going to end up with a result that is unfuzzy? And the answer is no, you're always going to like try to fuzzify your information more and more. So it's actually the difference between, if you know the difference between accuracy and precision, you'll probably know the difference between fuzzy sets and point values. So accuracy basically represents how close you are to the right solution, which fuzzy sets are good at doing. And precision represents how much you narrow down value. So if somebody asks me what is the age of this teenager, and you know, somebody tells me, you know, his age is probably in between, 1 to 100 or something, he's going to be incredibly accurate, but incredibly imprecise, versus someone who tells me, you know, his age is like 23. So he's more precise, but he might be less accurate as to what the person's age actually is. And that's exactly what fuzzy sets are to me, and what I got out of fuzzy sets. So the main reason we use fuzzy sets is because you want to represent linguistic variables. So a linguistic variable is represented by this quintuple, where the first element in the quintuple is new. It is just the name of the variable. So it's either hot, cold, whatever. T is the set of linguistic terms. New is not hot, cold, so on. So I'm so sorry. So new defines, if someone asks you what's the weather like today, then new defines that variable that you are equating to hot, cold, or so on. T defines the possible values that new can take, or at least the base values that new can take. That is hot, maybe cold, maybe normal. X is the universe of discourse. So it can be, it's just basically the universe set. I'll explain what G is. And finally, you have the meaning of every single term in the set of values. So for every single term that is hot or cold or normal, M of T defines a fuzzy set that represents, you know, hot, cold, and normal. And this is basically an example of how you'd use a fuzzy set. So the variable you're trying to define using fuzzy sets is this variable called performance of the system. I don't know what system it is. It's just performance. Very small. How is that performance? Anyway, it doesn't matter. So performance, and the performance can take, five possible values. The state of the performance variable can be five possible values: very small, small, medium, large, and very large. So this forms the base class of all the values that performance can take. Now your question is probably, you know, what happens if the value of whatever the base variable is somewhere here, in the middle of small, very small, and small, then this G that we define as a syntactic rule, it generates a label for a value here. So maybe it will be called slightly small. So you might not be reaching this definite state that you want to reach. Like, you probably want someone to tell you what is small or very small, or you want someone to tell you distinctly that it's small or very small. But what you end up with is a very accurate representation where someone tells you, you know what, it's not just very small, it's not small, it's slightly small. So you, that's what you end up with when you use fuzzy sets. So I think I'll end it here. I had a lot more, but I think I'm going to end it here because, you know, I take questions. I don't think this was right for a theory reading, I don't know, seminar, but it's fine. It got me to complete whatever this is that I wanted to complete. So any questions?
Hello.
Yeah.
Are there any well-known mappings between characteristic functions over a crisp set and a topology over a crisp set? So say, if I have a characteristic function, can I construct a topology somehow? Or if I have a topology, can I construct a characteristic function?
Yeah, this is embarrassing to say, but I have no idea what a topology is. Or maybe I do, and I don't know that it's called a topology. Let me check.
Does the textbook you link talk about this?
The textbook does not talk about topology. No.
Oh.
I mean, okay. Fuzzy sets as such is a very applied concept. I mean, the whole point of it is to do applied work, even though it has a theoretical basis. It's like relational algebra. They're built on top of theory, but they're meant for applications. So the book is very, it's very applied. So you have the first 9 chapters, which are the theory part. I think after this chapter, they cover relations, which I've done, but I didn't have time to present. They cover fuzzy logic. And then the next chapters, I think from 10 through 17 is just applications. So you just have like half the book to be applications. And the other thing was, I was actually expecting this magical thing where they tell me how to decide this membership function, right? Like you think, you know, fuzzy says they probably cracked the idea of how I'm going to like decide on what the membership grades are going to be. So if I want to call something small, I thought they'd already have this, they'd have this theoretically down. That's one of the reasons I did this, but no. When you go to the chapter where they try to find out, you know, what the membership grades are, you see stuff like neural networks and curve fitting, which is honestly a huge disappointment, but I can see why they did it. But yeah.
Are there any questions? Other questions? Okay, I'm stopping the recording in that case.